Hey, what's going on YouTube?
To celebrate the release of Avengers Infinity War this year, as the title of the video says, I'm going to present you with my ideal version of the upcoming Avengers Infinity War movie. This is not a prediction video or a speculation video. This is essentially me making the movie, showing you how I would love the film to play out. Now, I'm not saying I'm going to do better than what Marvel can do. I certainly hope I don't. This is just a little fun video I'm making to help tide you guys over until the real movie comes out. Here's the rules. I'm going to use everything that's been established before and use everything that's in the realm of possibility. So for example, no Silver Surfer or Galactus Fantastic Four showing up since Marvel don't have the rights to those properties. And...
what? What was that? Wait, what? You say what? Marvel's got the rights now. Oh shit. Damn, okay. Maybe Silver Surfer and X-Men and Fantastic Four might show up in this, or my version of Avengers 4, if I make one, who knows. Anyway, so with all that out of the way, so we've got to start where Thor Ragnarok left off. Yeah, I know Black Panther comes before Infinity War, but I don't know what Marvel planned to do with it in relation to Infinity War. So in 0088's version of the Marvel Cinematic Universe, Black Panther is an isolated standalone affair that doesn't really lead into Infinity War. Also, I haven't really seen the movie yet, so back to Thor and Loki. We last left off with them chilling up in space, looking for a new home after Asgard was destroyed by Surtur, and the fate of Hela unbeknownst to us. Then a big ass ship appears before Thor and company. This ship belongs to Thanos in my version of the movie, and most likely it will in the real version of the movie, I'm pretty sure about that. Thanos has been tracking the Infinity Stones and has been led straight to Thor's ship, which holds a bunch of Asgardians, Valkyrie, Loki, Korg, Hulk and Heimdall. Thanos' big ass ship opens up and eats Thor's ship, kind of like the Death Star in Star Wars, and Thor steps out asking, "What is this all about?" We are then introduced to the Black Order, Corvius Glaive, Ebony Maw, Proxima Midnight and Call Obsidian. No idea why they changed his name from Black Dwarf, but whatever, Call Obsidian sounds pretty cool actually. Proxima then steps up and says, "Welcome aboard the Sanctuary." That's the name of Thanos' ship in the comics, and that's the name of the ship in the movie, for me at least, I think. I'd have Thanos and crew be kind of surprisingly hospitable. Loki then would say, "I have a bad feeling about this," while Thor is being all clueless. Then Thanos finally shows himself, looking as grand as a big menacing purple titan can look.
"Thor, Prince of Asgard."
"King, actually."
"I believe you have something that belongs to me. The Tesseract."
"It's been destroyed, along with Asgard. What do you want with it?" Then Thanos says something sexily badass like,
"It is not wise to lie to a superior being."
Or something, some badass thing like that. I don't know, I'm trying to make this quick, alright? Anyway, Thanos reveals that the Tesseract is indeed in Thor's possession with some kind of energy detector. And Thor looks confused. Then Loki brings it out. He was hiding it all along with an illusion. It is revealed that Loki stole it during Ragnarok, like we didn't know that. Thor's pissed and he's all like, "Oh come on Loki, really? Well, I didn't know he was going to show up, did I?" And Thor and Loki continue bickering, and then Thanos shouts an epic
"Silence!"
Yeah, the whole room shakes from this badass yell. He tells Loki to give him the Tesseract, and Thor says, "No!" Loki says stop to Thor, but Thor doesn't understand that Thanos will destroy them all in an instant. Loki then slowly walks up to Thanos and presents him with the Tesseract, like in the Comic-Con trailer. And then just as Thanos is about to take it, Thor attacks. He's seen enough, and Thanos owns him quick, grabs him by the skull and shouts,
"Fool, now watch as I destroy your people."
Then Heimdall, Valkyrie, Hulk steps out ready to fight. The Black Order attack them and overpower them with ease and knock them out. Hulk takes them on and is putting up a good fight as Thanos is holding Thor by his skull. Thanos is intrigued by Hulk and exclaims,
"The Green Beast is powerful."
And Hulk replies in mid-fight,
"Purple and stupid."
Gotta get the jokes and comedy in there for the casuals. Thanos calls for the fighting to stop, and Hulk is standing there ready to continue. Thanos walks up to the Hulk, with Thor in hand, face to face with Hulk, and you could hear a pin drop, it's that intense. Thanos stares Hulk down like Bruce Lee in Enter the Dragon, and Hulk, for the first time ever, looks slightly intimidated. This would be a massive moment. Thanos, seeing Hulk as a dangerous threat, lifts a Tesseract between them and says,
"You will return from where you came, beast."
And the Tesseract flashes and Hulk disappears. Thanos then turns his attention to Thor and says,
"For your insolence, your people shall die.
Thor begs and struggles, and Thanos destroys Thor's whole ship and instantly kills all the Asgardians on board. Thor is in tears and Loki is horrified. Thanos grabs Thor and brings him up to his face and says,
"When you cross me, death is inevitable."
And he launches Thor out into the depths of space at high speed with his bare hands. Valkyrie and Heimdall are captured, and Loki looks at Thanos and kneels immediately. Thanos holds the Tesseract up and says to Loki,
"Despite your failures, you managed to deliver the Tesseract. You will be spared for now."
Thanos then crushes the Tesseract and takes the blue stone out of it and puts it on his gauntlet. And here it is revealed Thanos is actually already in possession of the Soul Stone, right smack in the middle of the gauntlet. This is also how he was able to track the Tesseract so easily. How did he get it? Stay tuned.
2 down, 4 to go.
Then the stones glows into titles, Avengers Infinity War. Da 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 da. Da da da. And now we've started with a bang. We've introduced Thanos and the Black Order, and Thor's people have been slaughtered. Thanos already has 2 Infinity Stones, and yeah, my version is pretty dark, but it kinda has to be. This is the culmination of 10 years worth of build. It's gonna get pretty dark. And now we get into Act 1 of how I would like Avengers Infinity War to play out. I would start with the continuation of Civil War, like the Russos have actually been hinting at while promoting Infinity War.
That the most compelling way to start off Infinity War would be to have the Avengers spread off to the ends of the Earth in complete conflict with each other when the greatest threat that they've ever faced shows up. And it's setting the groundwork for Infinity War, but you know, Civil War is not finished. It's going to, the story will continue. The story of this family will continue into those movies.
We open with a character we have not seen for a while, Tim Blake Nelson from The Incredible Hulk, who was playing Samuel Stearns. In the movie, he was hinted at becoming Marvel villain, the leader, but Marvel did nothing with it. Well, I'm gonna use him here. Samuel Stearns, aka the leader, with his huge head, is up to no good and has kidnapped some civilians in a warehouse, hiding in plain sight in the middle of the city in New York. He has the intention to perfect his Hulk formula. Yeah, I know, cliche bad guy plot, but that's not important, all right? All we need to know is that he's up to no good. Then a hooded man silently appears in the warehouse and says, "Stern, give it up. It's time to stop." Stern then sends his goons on the hooded man, and then they get beaten up in a flash while the camera is focused on Stern's horrified reaction. Then we cut to heroic shots of a blonde Black Widow, with shorter hair than in the promotional pictures of her in the official movie. Miss Johansson would be using her real-life haircut in my version, as a callback to her short hair that was freakishly exactly the same style in the Infinity Gauntlet comic. Yay! No more red wig for Scarlett Johansson. And we cut to a Hawkeye hero shot, Ant-Man finishing off some goons, Falcon bitch slapping some fools, Scarlet Witch looking hot, doing some mind-bending shit to a couple clowns. And then we cut to a big group shot of Scarlet Witch, Black Widow, Hawkeye, Ant-Man and Falcon all standing in front of the hooded man. He steps forward and he reveals himself, a bearded Captain America in his torn up Civil War suit. Stern then starts laughing. "Captain America? You're just as much as a criminal as I am. Perhaps I should be bringing you in instead." Widow then exclaims, "How did you escape from S.H.I.E.L.D.? I stopped you," which actually did happen in the Marvel tie-in comics. Stern replies, "Well, thanks to you, of course. You destroyed S.H.I.E.L.D., allowing for an easy escape, but you will not escape from here." Stern is about to set off an explosion, but then we hear a familiar voice. "I wouldn't do that if I were you." Vision then phases from the floor and knocks Stern out. Wanda looks shocked. Captain says, "Oh no." And we hear another familiar voice.
"Oh no, it's right."
And Tony breaks the door of the warehouse down. He's with Rhodes in the War Machine armor. Cap, thinking quick, says, "Everyone, scatter!" Falcon, Hawkeye, Wanderers get to the outside, and Ant-Man shrinks out of the warehouse and into the city. Iron Man and War Machine fly outside and land in front of Cap's team. Vision then lands beside Tony and Rhodes. Cap says, "You really want a repeat of Leipzig?" Tony replies,
"Yeah, actually, I believe he won that fight, right?"
"Fine, then we'll have a repeat of Siberia instead." And goes in for the attack. Vision floats in front of Cap, but Wanda takes him down, much like at the Avengers compound in Civil War. War Machine takes on Falcon and Hawkeye, while Ant-Man goes for Tony. He throws into an uppercut, and Widow then fly kicks into Tony. War Machine is putting up a good fight with Hawkeye, but he can't handle both Hawkeye and Falcon, and they end up overpowering Rhodes. Captain takes advantage and holds Tony in a headlock.
You really think you could stop us with just the three of you?
No, I didn't.
Steve, look out! And out of nowhere, Luke Cage gives a big, powerful punch to Captain America that sends him flying. Daredevil in a fully costumed Iron Fist kick Hawkeye and Falcon off Rhodes. And Jessica Jones barges into Scarlet Witch and sends her flying backwards. As Team Cap is recovering in shock, we see Team Tony forming with Iron Man, War Machine, Vision, Daredevil, Luke Cage, and Jessica Jones. Yeah, I know at the end of The Defenders, Daredevil is presumed dead and is incredibly injured, but let's just say this takes place in the middle or after Daredevil Season 3, for argument's sake. Tony says,
Steve, meet the Defenders. This is what it looks like when you fight alongside the law.
So you're still taking orders from Ross?
Ross? Steve, this is from the President. You can't go around being a vigilante, doing whatever the hell you want, not anymore.
Listen, we can fix this, Tony.
You told me in that letter that when I need you, you'd be there. Well, I need you now. I need you to give yourself up.
You know that's not gonna happen.
Then my hands are tied.
And then you guessed it, a big fight happens. It's not as crazy as the airport fight, but we get some one-liners and interactions from the Secret Avengers and the Defenders. This entire opening sequence is used to establish the Defenders for the sequel, to show that the Avengers are very much still fractured, and it makes Civil War feel more like a war rather than a civil dispute by having one final battle in New York while also paying homage to the big city battle from the comics. The fight ends fairly quickly when Cap notices the destruction that they're all causing. Cap tells everyone to stop. He turns himself in to stop the carnage, and Cap realizes this is not what the Avengers were supposed to be about. It's not what he's about. Tim Cap start looking all confused, and Steve says to Tony,
if you bring me in, you let them go?
And Falcon shouts, no! And Tony says, I'll see what I can do. We then cut to a prison scene where Cap is behind the bars and Tony is speaking to him. Sam and the others are being held at the new Avengers facility.
Held by your new friends? What do you call them? The Defenders?
I shouldn't be surprised you haven't heard of them, being on the run and all. You guys are looking pretty rough.
Yeah, keeping the world safe while trying to hide from it takes a lot out of you.
Speaking of hiding, where's Barnes?
You still want him dead?
Look, I understand he wasn't under his own control, and I understand that he's your friend, but he needs to be brought to justice.
You still want him dead? Did you think a letter was gonna fix this?
It's out of my hands now, Steve. That's up to the courts to decide.
They'll crucify him. You're not gonna talk. I don't want to see you rotten here, Steve. The quicker you give up Barnes, the quicker I can help you get the hell out of here. What's gonna happen to Sam, Wanda, and Clint?
They're going to be debriefed and signed up to the Accords. If they refuse, well, I'd call dibs on the top bunk.
Tony, I'm sorry for everything.
Yeah, I'm sorry too. And after all this madness, it becomes Thanos the movie and his search for the remaining Infinity Stones and the Avengers trying to stop him. We cut to Thanos aboard his ship. We get his motivation here. We find out that he's in love with death. Not just the idea of death, but the physical embodiment of death. And no, in my story, death is not Hela, played by Cate Blanchett, but it's actual death from the comics, played by Eva Green. Thanos feels the cosmic entity will only show herself to him if he has cosmic power himself and becomes her equal. And Thanos' way to get cosmic power? With the Infinity Gauntlet, of course. His end goal is to use the Infinity Gauntlet to be the most powerful cosmic entity in the universe. This way, death cannot deny him. We see Thanos in his ship, staring into the depths of space, talking to himself, staying true to his namesake, the Mad Titan. He's blabbering on about how he's just eradicated an entire race of people, and why is this not enough for death to show herself to him? Why does death still spurn him? Why is Thanos so in love with death? He was born with it. He had always had a fascination with power, death, and destruction. growing in power and infamy as he traveled the universe after causing unrivaled destruction. Thanos finally met Death herself as it appeared to him embodied in a female form. Thanos was infatuated with the being and endeavored to make himself worthy in order to earn her love in return. With an army under his command, he nearly destroyed his former home of Titan, declaring himself its ruler, but Death still would not come. Thanos had a premonition from Death and comes to believe there is too much life in the universe and must bring balance by causing more death. At some point, he reiterates this to Loki on his travels. Thanos travels to nowhere using the Space Stone, opens a massive portal where he faces off with the Collector. The Collector knows Thanos is coming and sets up his defenses, but Thanos wipes out the entirety of the Collector's army of Nowhere's inhabitants. After he tells his Black Order to sit back and watch him work, we see Thanos visibly laughing and enjoying all the death and destruction he's causing. He exclaims that everybody is dying for a noble cause to bring balance to the universe. Thanos then gets to the Collector, and the Collector notices Thanos has two Infinity Stones, but he is more concerned with the Soul Stone. The Collector claims it is the most powerful of all the Infinity Stones, and is essentially the heart of the universe. The Collector says if he has but one dying wish to learn how Thanos acquired the stone, as he had been searching for it forever to no avail. And Thanos obliged and said he obtained it a couple of years ago from a race known only as the Sovereign, the same race of gold people that was after the Guardians in the Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2. Thanos continues saying he defeated their strongest warrior and points out it was one of the most toughest battles he had ever been in. And he almost met Death herself, but not in the way he wanted. He managed to destroy the warrior and took the first of the six Infinity Stones. The Collector is amazed by this story and says that he'd do anything for it. Thanos, being the kind, reasonable Titan that he is, says he'll swap it for the Reality Stone, and the Collector cannot believe his luck as a trade is about to be made. Of course, you guessed it, the Collector's soul is sucked into the Soul Stone and his lifeless body falls to the floor, and Thanos collects both stones. Thanos now has three stones: Reality, Space, and the Soul. And now we're in Act 2. Of my version of Avengers Infinity War. We cut back to space and Thor comes into contact with the Guardians of the Galaxy on their ship. Thor explains about Thanos, and he and Gamora hit it off for their equal hate of Thanos. Thor says only one group of people that he knows are powerful enough to help the Avengers. Quill is nervous about going back to Earth after his trauma with his mother. But with a little encouragement from his friends, he's ready. Then they fly off into hyperspace to Earth in the Milano. We are back on Earth and we see a lost Bruce Banner who has been teleported back to Earth by Thanos earlier. He's searching for clothes on the way to the Avengers facility. Suddenly, a strange portal appears. See what I did there? Anyway, Banner gets sucked into it and is teleported to Doctor Strange's Sanctum Sanctorium. Just as established in Thor Ragnarok, Strange monitors anomalies and otherworldly occurrences that interfere with the Earth, and Banner's swift teleportation on Earth with the Infinity Stone triggered Strange to summon him. Banner then explains to Strange about Thanos. He tells him how, as the Hulk, he can never really remember his experiences, but with Thanos, he remembers it as clear as day. He never felt the Hulk feel fear before, and Banner felt that fear, and Banner says we have to find Tony Stark. Back at Avengers headquarters, we see Tony shooting his shit with the Netflix defenders who aren't so keen about the Accords themselves anymore. But Tony insists that if they want to continue defending New York streets, that they need to do it under the law, and the defenders leave Avengers HQ a little unsure of their new role. The Falcon comes up to Tony and explains that they've all finally signed the Accords and requests that Captain America be released. Tony says when he gives up Barnes, he will be. It's late at night at the Avengers facility. Vision and Scarlet Witch are talking. She apologizes for earlier. They begin reconciling and are glad to be on the same team again. There's a hint of a romance in this scene, but then suddenly both of them sense a strange presence. Vision senses it more intensely, something to do with their connection to the Mind Stone. Vision and Wanda go outside and are attacked by Proxima Midnight and Ebony Maw of the Black Order out of nowhere. They put up a decent fight, but the two members of Thanos' Black Order are unusually strong. They are losing until they are joined by Falcon and Hawkeye. Wanda asks the Black Order members what they want, and Proxima says, the heroes all look at Vision, and then with the strength of Cap Secret Avengers together, they manage to push back Ebony Maw and Proxima Midnight, and they escape through a portal. Falcon asks what the hell that was all about, and Hawkeye says we need to call Tony, and even Vision thinks that's a bad idea. Wanda suggests that they go hide Vision in Wakanda. They manage to hide from the world there, they can hide Vision there too. Falcon says if we're going to Wakanda, we'll need a Quinjet. And Widow steps out and says, and we'll need Steve.
And that's the end of part one. Part two is coming very soon. Let me know what you guys thought in the comments below. What was your favorite part? And what parts do you hope to see in the actual movie? And what parts did you see that you hope won't happen in the actual movie? It's really weird how similar this is to the actual trailer, considering I wrote all of this before the trailer came out. But I did take a lot of inspiration from the Comic-Con trailer. Thanks for watching, guys. And oh, if you loved part one, part two will blow you away. See you then.